Okay, so let's get going. What I did here in this webinar was explore the use of AI. And I'm saying AI instead of ChatGPT because I'm using some different tools here. But explore the use of it in terms of being a lean helper, a lean consultant to help analyze some of the data that we normally collect as part of the process of designing a value stream or designing an assembly line. So we have data already available for this experiment that we've been using for years and years, but I thought it would be good to kick the tires on ChatGPT and AI and see what kind of information we could get back that could be helpful. So that's basically the essence of it. So in terms of AI in general, this actually makes me kind of anxious. Or nervous because there's so much going on. And I subscribe to a couple of YouTube channels that try to keep on top of this, but every day or every week, there's just a mountain of stuff going on. So it's really hard to keep on top of. But here's a website that you could check out if you wish. There's an AI for that. I think that's the actual URL. There's an AI for that.com, something like that. And it says here, so it's a database for all the AI apps or applications that are coming out. And this is as of yesterday, 8,017 AIs for 2,177 different tasks. So why is the number of tasks less? Because a lot of these AI tools would do kind of similar things, like helping you to write marketing content or edit a document or et cetera, that kind of thing. And then it says could impact 4,847 jobs. I haven't looked into that exactly what they mean by that, but they show you what kind of jobs could be impacted by this AI. So that's a lot, 8,000. I imagine there are a lot of people out there who are trying to get on the bandwagon and come up with apps. I guess it's not that hard. Haven't done it myself, but I imagine a lot of these are going to go away as things mature. But for the time being, it's like a gold rush. You know, everyone trying to get in and create these different apps. So quite mind-boggling. So you can search and, you know, find apps that might be in line with what you're looking for. Now, here's what I used or at least explored in this presentation. There's something called ChatGPT for Excel. So it's a plugin for Excel. And since the data that I'm using is Excel-based, I thought, well, let's see what this will do. I didn't spend a whole lot of time on it. It just didn't look like it was going to give me what I wanted. It seemed to have some kind of chat capability where you could, it basically creates like an Excel function. But I didn't really have good luck with that. I didn't want to spend too much time on it, but that exists and maybe remains for the future. The other thing is we're using something called custom GPT. So custom GPT allows you to set up your own private chat bot. And we're using that in our website, the Lean Design Studio. And we're loading in our information, our own Leonardo Group information, you know, mixed model manufacturing information from our books, from our webinars, from our YouTube channel. And then it uses that as the source, the data source. And so that's pretty useful for very specific questions related to mixed model manufacturing, but not so useful for more generalized kind of queries. So that didn't seem to work out as well. And then we have ChatGPT. I have the paid version, you know, it's $20 a month or so. And so I'm getting ChatGPT 4. That works great, except for one thing. And I think there's a way to do it. I just haven't figured it out. Maybe if you can figure this out, let me know in the chat here. But to upload a file kind of dynamically, because I wanted to upload my Excel data. So I didn't quite see that. Again, I didn't spend a whole lot of time trying to figure it out either. So if I didn't see it right away, I just kind of moved on. But if that's there, let me know. So I ended up using for most of this AI query chatting something called Claude AI. So Claude is pretty much like ChatGPT, it seems like. But it does have a couple additional capabilities. Number one, there's a little link there so you can upload a file. not any kind of file, but certain formats it will accept and be able to analyze. So that was very handy. Second thing is Claude apparently will accept bigger amounts of text. One thing with ChatGPT is it's very easy to run into the limits. So if the text that you're, even your query is too long, it'll tell you, hey, you need to shorten this up. Claude, I guess, is 4 or 5 times larger. So that was helpful as well. I never ran into any limitations with Claude in terms of the queries, the length of the queries. Claude is also paid, paid about the same price, I think, as ChatGPT. So it's not hugely expensive. So that's what we're using. So here's what I started with in Claude. I said, hey, Claude, give me 10 great uses or applications for using AI to help a company build a lean enterprise or help implement lean manufacturing. Give me 10 areas that you could be helpful. And so it gave me 10 that I asked for. And if you want to see those 10, you'll have to download the PDF. But it gave me a nice list of 10 reasonable things that Claude or AI could be used for. And one of them was process mining, or data mining, I think is a more common term. So I thought, well, that would be an interesting one to explore. So that's what triggered this webinar. So let's look at the data that we typically use in our mixed model manufacturing work or line design work, and see what kind of information we can get out of it. So that's really what triggered this. So here's what we're gonna look at. And I hope to get through this relatively quickly so we can have time for some questions at the end. But here are the kind of issues that or opportunities that we looked at for processing. First is just a simple one-page Excel worksheet where we look at the products, the volumes, and the processes, and then we do calculations of takt time and resources, number of resources by process, etc. So this is something far we can get there. Second thing is, based on that, could we do a product family analysis? The issue here is that you might have a list of products and you want to mix them, but maybe not all of them are good candidates for mixing from a number of different dimensions. And one of them is the commonality of processes. Do they all have the same process flow, or do you have different flows, and how different could they be to still have a good grouping of products? So that's product family analysis. Now, the third thing is something that may be new to a lot of you, but we're using something called the Lean Design Simulator, which is our own simulation software. So it's a discrete event simulation software. But it works just like basically any other ones that are out there. So we have data that you would need to provide to a simulation model. And so we're going to use that data file and see what kind of good feedback we can get from that. So that's the data file side of it. And then we have the results file. So when you actually run a simulation, you're gonna get some information back, usually more than you need, a mountain of it. So this is where AI could be very, very useful in terms of analyzing that data and giving us some kind of useful feedback. For example, like where are the bottlenecks? Based on the data I'm providing, where are the bottlenecks in the flow that we need to focus on? Because they're not everywhere. So that's the results file. And then based on that same line, the simulation data, we want to do some things like line balancing. So if we have, say, a process like final assembly, you might have 10 different stations. If you want to organize those stations, did Richard freeze for everyone? I hope not, but if you did, you might restart. Okay. If you can hear my voice, then maybe you don't care. So line balancing is how you would organize a work into individual work stations, like an assembly line. Sequencing rules are what's the optimal order of doing the work within a mixed model line? Which products should I do first, second? What's the optimal mix? to level the workload. And then the third one is buffers or IPKs, in-process Kanbans. So offer some optimum buffer suggestions. So these are all very useful things that we might want to know, right? So that we'll go through these one by one and talk about them. So the first one is the static line design analysis. So this is the one-page line design worksheet that we typically would do. So I'll show you what that looks like here. There we go. So again, I understand that this might look a little small. It depends how big your monitor is. I can read it on my screen, but I've got a big monitor in front of me. So static line design spreadsheet. So you can see on the left side, we have the products or the part numbers and descriptions, and then volumes. This is for design purposes. How many of these do we want to be able to build in a day? This is a daily rate. And then we have some assemblies. This is a subset of the resource calculation worksheet that we do for our that we use in our live workshops, our line design workshop. But it's about 16 or more processes, so I wanted to shrink it down a little bit, so I chose the ones. And you can see from the description, it's a bicycle factory. So we have disc brake assembly, standard brake assembly, handlebar assembly, and then final assembly, final inspection, and bicycle pack. So we're leaving out building the frame, building the wheels, some other processes that are not included here. And then down below, we do some calculations. So we calculate the volume going through each of the processes. It's not the same. For example, a disc brake is an option, so we're not doing them for all the bikes. Then we calculate takt time, the rhythm or beat for each of those processes to achieve that volume. And then the sum of the sum product is an intermediate calculation that gets us to the standard time weighted. So what's the weighted work content time for that process? And then based on that and based on the takt time, how many people are reading? This is next to the last row there. And then because it's a fraction, how many do we actually need if we round up or round down? So workstations is, you know, how many actual physical workstations would we need to do this work? So all that's good stuff. It's not everything you would need. For example, line balancing is not included in here. This is the total process. So final assembly is all the work to do final assembly. It's not the work per station, but that's what we're doing. Now, Claude would not accept an Excel file directly, at least not in the current version. So I had to save this as a CSV file, which is not a big deal, but it was an extra step. And then I could load the CSV file into Claude, and then it can do its thing. So in each of these examples, I'm going to share with you what I asked Claude to do. And then some of the feedback. I mean, sometimes it was a lot of feedback, but I tried to summarize it for you here. So in this first one, I didn't tell it a lot, right? I just said, hey, what can you tell me about this file I just uploaded? I didn't tell it was a resource calculation file. I didn't tell it was mixed modeling. I didn't tell it anything. I just told it what you see here. Tell me what you can see in this CSV file. So it came back with a lot of accurate information. Right? It contains product details, part numbers, descriptions, volumes, labor times, listed all the processes. Calculations are included for total times, takt time, weighted standard time, required research. All of that is accurate. And then it says, it seems to be laid out as an initial spreadsheet for designing a mixed model assembly line. I didn't even tell it the term mixed model. So I don't know where it picked that up exactly. That's kind of a specialized term. But it's using it. So mixed model assembly line, yes. Labor time data could be used to analyze and identify bottlenecks or balance the line. Yeah, to a certain extent. Volume show a mix of high and low runners. Yes, true. Takt time and resources required are calculated. Yes. So the summary of this analysis is this is structured as a useful starting data set that could be further analyzed with process mining techniques to optimize the assembly line design and improve flow. So what's interesting here is that Claude is saying, hey, yeah, this is good data, but it's a starting point. It's calling it a useful starting data set. So that's kind of an insight that's surprising to me, that it not only knew what that file was, but it actually was able to say, well, this is good, but this is not really sufficient, but it's, you know, it's a good starting point, which also is a true observation. So good start. And so then I tried to, you know, kick the tires a little bit more. So I said, okay, well, based on what I've given you, which is not a whole lot, but I gave you a list of products and a list of volumes and some times, processing times. What I asked was, if the products shown here can be mixed in the final assembly line, please provide a suggested sequence, optimum sequence, in order to mix high and low work content products. How do I level load this list of products? And the answer was, okay, here's a suggested optimized sequence to mix high and low work content. And it gave me the order. I have 10 different products, and it says, here's the order in which you should probably run them. So again, this needs to be tested, right? Verified, but at least it had no problem in understanding what I was asking for and then doing it and actually giving me some additional commentary. This one's a high work content. This is a medium work content product, you know, organizing it in that way. And it gave me a reason for starting with the first one. It says high work content due to disc brake assembly. Start with that one. Okay. So again, don't know if this is the right answer or the optimum answer, but this is, you know, a good start that needs to be tested. Okay, so then just in moving on, the other question that I wanted to ask at this level of detail, the data we had was, do these products make sense to mix? So it's called a process family analysis. And we would normally do this in a spreadsheet format with a macro to do some of the analysis. And that's pretty easy to do. And what you can see here, this is the result, again, of our bicycle factory, where it organized the different bicycles based on commonality of process. So it's not looking at the processing time. It's just looking at the commonality of process flow. And it identified three different groupings. So we have yellow, the green, and the orange color, right? So three families. So I have that as the data. This is the quote unquote right answer. And so I asked Claude, okay, do the same thing for me. So I said, please sort this matrix, the information I gave you, by grouping together the products that have exactly the same process flow, the same series of X's. And give me a list of products by grouping and tell me how many groups there are in total. And so it did that. Pretty much everything happens kind of instantaneously. It doesn't take long for it to make up its mind. And it came back and said, there are four groups with identical process flows. Group one has the high volume standard models, tandem models, and then mountain bikes and modern bikes. So I said, that's interesting. There are four, but my analysis says there are three. So it looks like there's a misunderstanding or a little error here. So I went back and I asked a question. I said, does the tandem group have the same X sequence as the standard men's group? And then Claude, I don't know if you've had this experience, if you use ChatGPT, you know, if it makes a mistake, it'll be perfectly honest in admitting that it made a mistake. So again, we can't trust these results 100%. But Claude said, good catch, you're right. I made a mistake in my previous groupings. Looking closely, the tandems have the same X sequence as the standard men's model M8234. So there are now three groups in total with common X patterns. And it gave me the actual groupings. So that's an interesting thing too, isn't it? I have no idea. And I don't know if anyone has an idea what's going on inside these AI models. What the thinking is exactly or how it works. In the old days, you'd write a computer program and it would be highly structured. It would be rule-based. Say, do this, do this, do this. And if you had an error, you'd have to go back and you could find that line of code where that error occurred. These days, I don't think it works that way. You basically, I've been told that the actual AI code, the source code, is relatively modest. Someone said, I read somewhere that like a ChatGPT type model is 4,000 lines of code or less. So I don't know if that's true or not. Don't quote me on that. But basically, it learns and develops on itself. 89-layer LLM deep learning algorithm trained on the entire internet. All right. So there we go. Thank you, Ruben. So what's going on inside is kind of a black box. But in any case, it says good catch. I made a mistake. Here's the correction. And that correction is correct, right? It came up with the right answer. All right. Next thing we want to look at is standard work definitions. So standard work, foundational concept in Lean. And one of the things we typically have to do, if you're doing work in a sequential format, like an assembly line, is you have to take a chunk of work and you have to group it or divide it, balance it by individual workstation. And normally you do that by adding up the times to get to a certain time target, and then you go to the next station and allocate those tasks to that station, et cetera. So let's see how well we can do here. So this is going to be real hard to see unless you have a bigger monitor, but don't worry about it. I'll tell you what you're looking at. You're looking at a mountain bike. So it's one of the 10 bicycles in our factory, our bicycle factory. And what you see listed here are the work steps in final assembly. So first one is mount frame onto assembly fixture, et cetera, et cetera. So going through all the steps to assemble the bicycle, the mountain bike. So it's a specific model. And we didn't populate this entire sheet completely, but we have at least labor setup times and labor times. So the value added time, and then some self-check comments. So it's a pretty bare bones standard work definition. But again, I had to save this to a CSV file and then load it up to Claude and ask some questions. So first question I asked was, tell me what you see here. What is this? What is a CSV file? Again, without helping too much, right? That's all I asked. And it came back and says, hey, this is a standard work definition for assembling a standard mountain bicycle on a multi-product flow line. So pretty good insight there. And then it gave me, I won't read this to you, but gave me a description of, you know, all the, you know, the main steps in that assembly process. And then in summary, at the end, it said, in summary, this document captures the standard work required to assemble a mountain bike on a flow line. Yes, that is true. With all key operations, parts, times, and quality checks defined. Okay, this can be used to standardize the assembly process. Beautiful. What more could I ask for? So that pretty much seems like it understood that. So then my next question was this, and here's my actual prompt. Please divide the work into 5 sequential workstations, balancing the work between stations as evenly as possible. Give me the start and end task number for each of the 5 stations, plus the total time for each. And it did that. I didn't duplicate that here in this slide, but you can get it in your PDF file if you downloaded that. So the summary was, back from Claude, was, in this case, I've assigned whole tasks. I asked it to do that. You can't subdivide the task, right? Whatever time is associated with the task, you can't divide that. So I assigned whole tasks to each station while trying to balance the times as close to the average of 1.56 hours. It should be minutes. Well, I didn't tell it the time unit of measure, but 5.6 hours, it says, is actually minutes, as possible. Since the task times cannot be subdivided, true statement, there's some unavoidable imbalance. That's a true statement, but I've been assigning tasks to each station within the time limits. Beautiful. Who could ask for more? The station times range from 1.3 hours, should be minutes, to 2.3, which is a reasonable spread given the whole task constraint. Okay, in other words, I did the best job I could with the data you gave me, but one of them is 2.3 minutes, which is going to be a problem, right, that we'll have to fix. But at least we know where it is. So it says, let me know if you'd like to modify the workstation assignments, et cetera. So I don't think a human could do this any differently, really. You'd go through and you'd group to a time target, and you'd end up with one station, I think it's the first one, with 2.3 minutes. And then you'd have to subdivide those tasks further down, maybe do a better job of task definition with more detail. There are various things you could do there. Worst case, if it was totally not subdividable, you might have to have two station ones to get that throughput through to down to a sufficient level. But I don't think I would have come up, for example, with anything too different from this. The difference is this was done instantaneously, basically. As soon as I typed in my prompt, it started generating the answer. So that's one advantage is speed. So I was pretty pleased with that. And that gives me a good tool for the future when we have to do this, right? A good way to get at least a first draft of line balancing. Okay, next thing. How are we doing on time? Pretty good. So simulation. So this is our lean design simulator data file, which conveniently uses an Excel file for the data and also an Excel file for the output. So this is very useful in terms of trying to communicate this information up to Claude. So very briefly speaking, we have a number of worksheets in our data, in our lean design simulator data file. First one is, what are the resources? So this is at the workstation level. So I have assembly station 1 through 5. I have a test station, a pack station. And then I have some people, operators. So I have 3 different labor categories. So I have a final assembly operator, test operator, sub-assembly operator. All right. So I've defined all that with various other parameters. Second worksheet is the flow. So I'm defining what goes first, what goes second, how are they connected. So I have a column here. It's column D, which is, column C, which is the station. And then column, HIJ says next location, where it defines where does it go next. And that you can split the flow, et cetera. You have some flexibility there, but basically defines essentially the value stream, right? What's connected to what, in what order, and where's the end? So that's 2 important pieces of information. The other 2 that we're going to provide to Claude are products and process times. So the products are a list of in simulation lingo, they sometimes call this the entities, but what are the units or the products going through this flow? So we have 6 different products plus, you don't see the second one, but we have 2 sub-assembly products, and they all have part numbers or IDs related to those. And then the last thing is, what are the work content times? So again, this is a partial list that you see in the slide, but for every product and station, we need a time. So this assumes you've done line balancing already. Right? You've gone through the line balancing process and assigned times for every product and every resource or every station. So this is a kind of a long list of times, work content times. All right. So this is what we fed to Claude. I'm not going to spend our webinar time right now sharing with you or reading this to you. But basically, I asked Claude for every one of those 4 sheets to give me an analysis. What do you see here? I just wanted to check and make sure that Claude, the AI system, was really understanding what it is they were looking at. And I found no problem. Claude, really understood in wonderful detail exactly what it was looking at. So there was the resource sheet. There was a flow sheet. There was the product sheet. Again, so it identified all the products, identified the subassemblies, et cetera. And then processing times, understood that as well. Including some comments on time variation, which was not, I didn't ask for it, but it gave me that in its analysis. All right. Now, here's what I wanted it to do. A validation check. Now, in our lean design simulator, we do validation as well. So it's not something that I didn't have already, but I asked it to compare various worksheets. I uploaded 4, and it says, looking closely across the 4 spreadsheets. So it identified it had 4, and it's using the 4, and it's comparing the 4. And Claude said, I do not see any data discrepancies in terms of mismatching resource codes or other integration issues. For example, if you defined a resource and then you're using that resource on another worksheet, it needed to be the same, right? Spelled the same. If you had a typo or something in there, that's problematic. Now, again, we're checking for that when you run the lean design simulator, but Claude did this as well. And so it matched everything up. It knew what was related to what and did a data check. It did have some comments here. It said minor notes, some fields are unused, and that's true, and that's not a problem, but it noticed that. And also some times are left blank. But Claude said, well, it makes sense to leave them blank if there's no time. But these do not, and Claude said, these do not represent true discrepancies In summary, I do not see any data integration issues. What always surprises me, and I, you know, maybe some of you can comment on this, is the kind of the level of insight seems to be coming out of Claude or ChatGPT. I do not find any true discrepancies, no data issues, makes sense to leave them blank. How does it know that, that it makes sense to leave them blank? So it just feels like there's some intelligence happening here, that this is not just mechanics. It's makes me nervous. Okay, so we validated the file. Now let's have it do some work on this this data. So first thing I asked it to do was develop some sequencing rules. So the issue here is if you have high work content products and lower content products, or higher and lower within a range, and you're mixing them, you want to be intelligent about the mix. Because if you have, for example, too many high work content products back to back, that's going to create like a bubble in the flow. It's going to cause everything upstream to slow down or back up, and everything downstream to kind of dry up. So you don't want that to happen. So you want to balance or mix the flow in a mixed model line as much as possible. So sequencing rules is not a minor detail. So here's what I asked Claude to do. I said, based on the work content times provided, and assuming that these products can be mixed one after another, assuming you can mix them, please provide an optimum sequencing plan that mixes high work content products with low work content products as smoothly as possible. And again, I didn't copy all of Claude's response because it gave me a detailed plan, but I summarized it here. So the recommendations are high work content product 5, do that first, get it moving, then mixes low content product 2 to offset product 5, product 3 and 4 sequence to balance the longer product 5, product 6 is uses a quick product fill gaps. So summary, this plan balances the line utilization across high and low work on times as smoothly as possible. At least Claude is claiming that, but it gave me the actual, you know, detail that you would need to create a production plan based on this suggestion. So, okay, this needs to be tested, and it could be tested in the simulator, right? That was something we would want to do, go into the Lean Design Simulator and test it and test the results. But at least we now have a recommendation. Next thing I wanted some recommendation on is in-process Kanbans. So in-process Kanban or IPKs, these are buffers. So units allowed in between stations to overcome some of the time variation so that the workstation is not waiting if the downstream station can't pull it or consume it right away. You're at least allowed a certain amount of time to continue working upstream. So the interesting challenge here is that there's no real formula for an in-process Kanban per se, because it depends on the level of variability of those times. So you can't just say, here's the formula and here's the right answer. As the mix changes, you know, in your flow, as the daily volumes might fluctuate, then those buffers could actually change as well. So what we usually say, just the simple rule of thumb is, hey, if you have no idea and you can use an IPK, because sometimes you can't, maybe the products are too big, or maybe the takt time's longer than, you know, longer than needing an actual buffer, then just put one unit and kind of see what happens. So usually we size buffers based on experimentation as much as anything, but I wanted a little, maybe more scientific results. So I said to Claude, give me a Kanban plan. Now, in my prompt, I add a little bit more detail because I wasn't sure if Claude actually knew what a IPK was or what it was used for. But basically, my prompt was down below a little bit more. I said, please analyze the flow, taking into consideration the recommended sequencing and the processing times provided, and suggest an IPK plan for each primary resource. No IPKs are needed for O or operator resources. So if it's an operator resource, no IPK is needed. We're just talking about the workstations and how many pieces do you allow at the downstream side. And then the summary answer was here. I suggest IPK 1 for assembly 1, assembly 3, test 2 buffer key transition points, and IPK of 2 pieces or 2 units for assembly 5 to account for product 5 workload. No IPK is needed for the other stations. So that's a more detailed IPK than usually we you know, that are able to provide if we were just doing everything manually. So that's interesting. So that's different from just saying, hey, put one after every station and see what happens. So that is good. And again, this is something that would need to be tested, but I was really pleased with that level of detail. Okay, last thing I wanted to, next thing I wanted to ask for was feeder line recommendations. Again, this is related to buffers. I didn't see exactly recommendation for the subassembly feeder line. So I gave it a prompt. I said, we never want the subassembly to be a bottleneck. What's the recommended strategy? And it gave me actually a very detailed strategy. Again, look in the PDF file. It gave me something like five different strategies to connect a feeder line directly to a downstream process. But in general, it says, Claude says this, I believe an IPK of 3 units would provide a buffer while not overloading the line with excess WIP. Again, that seems kind of insightful to me, right? You don't want to overload, you don't have too many units, you don't want to overload with WIP. I didn't prompt him for that. I guess it's a him. Claude came up with that on his or her self. So pretty impressive. Okay. And then line balancing analysis. What we're trying to do here is look at line balancing again from the point of view of the more detailed information that we gave it with the Lean Design Simulator file, which it didn't have initially. So process time worksheet shows line balancing times for each product and resource. So we gave it a detailed times for every station, every product. So please analyze this for line balancing. The goal would be to have a station to station, I say resource to resource, variation of no more than 5%. So try to level it by product, try to level it to no more than 5%. That's just a rule of thumb. It's never going to be balanced perfectly, right? But try to keep it within 5%. And the recommendations it came back with, this is on a product by product basis now. It says product 5 needs to be addressed. Okay, so product 5 is a problem. Okay, that's good to know, right? Don't need to focus on everything. Product 2 to be looked at as well. And then it says product 2 through 4 and product 6 are well balanced already. So that's extremely helpful, right? Here's where you need to focus on the line balance. It's not on everything, not on every product. And if you had 50 products, you know, that would be even more helpful, right? To know which ones are probably okay and which ones need to be focused on. So the summary is line is fairly well balanced with just product 5 needing focus to smooth the variation under 5%. But he also mentioned product 1. So let me know if you need any additional analysis. So it could do more apparently, but we left it at that. So again, very pleased with that. Okay, next thing I wanted to look at was Lean Design Simulator results. So I took the recommendations that Claude gave me, I put it into our Lean Design Simulator, and I ran the simulation. And then what we get out of that is an output file showing the number of, the percent of value-added times, percent block time, percent waiting time, number of units, the throughput during the time, et cetera. So I gave Claude all of that information. And I asked it, first of all, take a look at this output from the simulation modeling run. Tell me what you see. And it gave me a completely accurate summary of what it saw, right? Codes, capacity, entries, percent busy, et cetera. All of that is correct. And it gave me a little summary of the busiest stations, the ones that had the highest utilization, and the ones that had the lowest utilization. And then here's an additional insight, which again, Claude somehow knew. It said, this seems like output from a discrete event simulation modeling production line. So again, I didn't tell it was a discrete event simulation model. I just gave it some data, but it somehow figured that out. Again, surprising. And then I said in my next prompt, please identify the biggest constraint. And so it identified a couple of the stations, assembly 1 and assembly 2, had the highest percentage of time blocked. This indicates that nearly 68% and 36% of the time, the stations could not operate because the next downstream station, assembly 2, assembly 3, was full. Since these are at the beginning of the line, it would restrict the overall throughput. So, and then there's some recommendations on what might be done. And it says here, increasing capacity at these stations would likely improve throughput. Okay, well, that is an option, add resources. And then my follow-on prompt was, if capacity can't be increased, what other solutions are there? Okay, so then it gave me a nice long list here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 other things that could be done to improve the throughput that could be tried out in the simulation model and in the real world as well. Buffering was one of them, a better job of line balancing, improved changeover times and flexibility, optimized product mix. So again, looking at the sequencing rules again, shift schedule and line balancing, et cetera. So again, some good recommendations, things that could be worked on. Now, back to humans versus AI. Could a human come up with these suggestions? Sure, absolutely. I mean, that's kind of what we do. But the fact that it did it more or less instantly, and it did a pretty complete job. So, a human might have come up with some of these, but maybe not thought of everything, right? Maybe not brainstormed every possible solution. So, again, very useful starting point. Now, here's the last thing. We have 15 minutes left if we were going to go for an hour. So here's the one that was potentially the most mind-blowing. So I already shared with you, we have a discrete event simulation modeling software tool that we use, right? The Lean Design Simulator. And the Lean Design Simulator works in kind of a mechanical fashion. What it does is the term discrete event means there are events that happen in the model. The event could be, okay, I finished a product, or I'm moving the product to the next station, or I'm waiting, or I was blocked, so I'm waiting because I can't move it out of the station. All those are events. And what the simulation model does is it runs in simulation time. And when it hits an event, it will record, what's happening and record the times, start gathering data. And so it runs in a pretty mechanical way, kind of like you would do as a human being, just moving little chess pieces on a board. And when an event happens and something has to move, you would move it and you keep track of the time on a whiteboard. It kind of does that, but it does it like a zillion times faster and keeps track of the data automatically. So that's discrete event simulation modeling, but still in its heart of hearts, it's kind of a mechanical process. So AI-based simulation, what I did here is, because it had the data already, I asked Claude, okay, can you run this for me? Can you give me an estimate of the throughput? I didn't take it more than that. Maybe that's for another day. But I said, give me an estimate based on the data that I have. What's the expected throughput of this line design, right, of this model? Okay, so let's take a look at that. I asked it three questions, actually, three prompts, so the three cycles. First one was what you see here. I said, based on the data provided in the 4 spreadsheets and assuming a warm-up time of 30 minutes and a runtime of 500 minutes, what would be the expected throughput? This should include any blocked or waiting time that might be incurred. So I did that. It came back with some data, and it didn't look to me like the waiting time or the block time that was going to be there was included. I wasn't sure about that. So I said in my second prompt, in the above expected throughput analysis, was potential wait time and block time taken into consideration? And it came back and said, nah, kind of, sort of, but let me do it again, right, and do a better job. So it did. But when it did a better job, it came up with changeover times. And this is another strange thing about the intelligence. It knew that when I change from one model to another, there probably would be some changeover time. I didn't tell it that, and that was not in the model. But it assumed a certain amount of changeover time, I think 5 minutes. It said, I included 5 minutes every time you did a changeover. I said, well, that's creative of you. I didn't ask for that, but interesting thing, right? Interesting a creative step. So in my third prompt, I said, please assume there's no changeover time between models, and that the change from one model to another can be done with no delays. does this change the analysis? And it came back and said, yeah, it changes it. We take out all the change over time, and here are the new results. So here are the results it gave me. Total runtime, 530. Production time, I think the reason that the production time was less was I didn't actually give it a production plan. So what it did was it ran each of the models, the six different products, and then was done. So it got done before the 530 minutes. So that's another thing that could be experimented with. But it came back and said, okay, blockages was 18 minutes. So 10% allowance. Where did it come up with that? I don't know. And then 5% allowance for IPK time, right? Time where the unit's sitting in the IPK, 9 minutes. Total wait block time, 27. So the sum of those two. And then the total time was 183 minutes of value adding time plus 27 minutes of waiting time is total time of 210 minutes. So then it completed 60 units. So 10 of each of the, I was asking to do batches of 10. So it did 10 of each of the six products in 210 minutes or 0.286 units per minute. Usually we don't measure it in units per minute, but that's an accurate calculation. So units per minute. So that's great. So it gave me an estimate. We think we can do 60 units in that amount of time. So then I went back to the simulator and I said, okay, let's run it for 210 minutes. And how many units do we get based on the discrete event simulation methodology, the kind of the mechanical way of looking at it, and see how they compare. Are they even close? Because if they're not even close, then that tells me this isn't, you know, this doesn't work at all, just doing AI-based simulation. So I did that. I ran it in a simulator, and here's the actual Lean Design Simulator results. So warm-up time zero, I just said, just start running it, run for 210 minutes. How many do we get? And orders completed 54 compared to 60. So that was like, wow. Like I asked AI to run this model with, I didn't say anything about discrete event simulation. I don't know what it was doing, right, to come up with that number, but that number 60 is very close to this number 54 that I have. Now, which number would I trust more? I trust this one, right? The discrete event model more than the 60. But the fact that 60 and 54 are very close says that there's some kind of AI-based logic where it could take that data and get very close. So this is something I need to explore, you know, obviously in the future more. But it was kind of shocking, actually, to see how close it was. Because I doubt that it's doing discrete event simulation modeling in the AI model. It's getting to that similar result in some other kind of way, but I'm not sure what it is. So it's kind of mind blowing a little bit. Okay, so observations about all these experiments, just to summarize, spreadsheet format seems to be flexible. So what I'm suggesting here is that if you load data into ChatGPT or Claude, it's not too picky in terms of what data is in which column and how you've organized it. It seems to be able to interpret or analyze that data and be accurate in terms of what it is and where things are. So that's the good news. I was a little concerned that what happens if we don't have this type of information in this row and in this column? Is that going to be a problem? It doesn't seem to be. All right. Excel instead of a CSV format would be preferable. So maybe this will come in the future. It would be great to not have to convert CSV. It just takes, you know, a few seconds or a minute or something, but it'd be better to be able to read Excel files directly, and maybe that already exists somewhere. The analysis and recommendations seem to be pretty much solid. Like I showed there, but you know, so things need to be checked, but in general, the recommendations and the analysis and the observations it was making were accurate. They would be like any experienced lean consultant would make. In fact, probably a little bit more complete because it wouldn't be forgetting things and leaving things out. Sanity check needs to be applied to result. Yes, as I said before, there were some mistakes, but in general, surprisingly, even maybe shockingly good analysis, good solid analysis of that, you know, of all the different examples that we gave it. So, you know, what comes next for me or for us? What I'd like to do is experiment with this AI-based simulation and get some idea of what's going on here. Result, Peter says, result could be random. Perhaps run a number of different simulations. Yeah, definitely run some experiments. Also, maybe do a better job of defining the two, you know, scenarios: the AI based data, and then the discrete event, and make sure that we're truly running, you know, running the same information, and give AI actually a sequence, right? Give it a production plan to use rather than what it was doing. So I think more work can be done there. But if we get to the point where discrete event simulation and AI simulation is actually generating the same or similar results, that's kind of a breakthrough of some kind, right? I guess. So I want to spend some time on that. And as Peter said, you know, do some more experimentation. But that could be very interesting, I would say. That would give all of you watching this, if that were true, that would give all, you know, as long as we understand the data that's needed, kind of like free simulation modeling, especially if we can drill down even further, not just the throughput, but, you know, what utilization and all the good information we get from normal simulation modeling tool. The other idea that I want to explore in the future, this is more for my use or for the Lean Design Studio use, is come up with an app that can automate some of this, some of the steps that I had to do manually. For example, if you had an Excel file, could you just upload it and then get all this analysis and recommendations back pretty much automatically? In other words, have the prompts predefined. Basically, what kind of questions might you want to ask? Because they're not different all the time. They're probably similar. In most cases, what kind of good questions would you want to ask of this data, and just package that whole process, right? So you could just be able to upload a file and click go and get back, you know, really good analysis in about 60 seconds. That would be awesome. And I don't think, but based on what I've seen, I don't think that's that hard to do either. So this would be another app added to the, there's an AI app for that list, but specific to our industry, right? To lean manufacturing, industrial engineering. Third thing I want to do, and you all can do this as well. It's hard to keep up with this, but this website, there's an AI for that, lets you search on various things. So I'm interested in seeing, you know, seeing what's available out there. But it changes daily. I mean, literally changes daily. Like today, this morning, I got a message that Google came up with some kind of enhancement to, is it Bard? So that, what was it that Bard could do? I can't remember. But it's like Bard is starting to be integrated into a bunch of the Google you know, products, and they had some kind of major announcement that came out today. So, I mean, it's like just about every day. And this tool that I just mentioned, I want to make that part of our Lean Design Studio as well. As a matter of fact, let me share with you, we're almost done here, folks. I've added a section to the Lean Design Studio, which is a kind of our platform for mixed model manufacturing courses and the simulator, the Lean Design Simulator's in there. And I added a section on AI, where we can start documenting some of these prompts and some of these results, like this webinar will get packaged up and put into there, so we can kind of keep track of this, because this is not going to stop, right? It's just going crazy. So we want to try to, as best as possible, take advantage of this as we can, right?